affected us. Number two, when there is the putrid phenomena, the foul smell you see comes over from these regions because of the presence of anaerobic bacteria. Now the organism, you find the Staphylococcus aureus there, Streptococcus viridans is there, and Peptostreptococcus is there. These are the organism which causes the pathogenesis in the other are the Klebsiella pneumonia, and you have the the patient is very much immunocompromised. Now the presentation. The presentation, unusual presentation, sometimes you have virus use of antibiotics, profound immunosuppression, cellulitis, necrotizing cellulitis, and sometimes you have the thrombophlebitis. Now in this picture you will see this is a huge swelling of the neck region which is due to the paraffinal space infection. And sometimes you will find the cellulitis. Next picture you see there is the cellulitis, and when the inflammation is spread through the blood to the various organs through the thrombophlebitis. Thrombophlebitis means inflammation of the blood vessel through the microemboli travels to the various organs, including your brain, including your heart, including your kidneys, including your ovaries, and it causes the inflammation over there. Now the examination, how you will carry out the examination, the rapid initial assessment will be there, and you have to patient go to the physical examination, you have to take the complete history, physical examination, and then third one is the imaging and laboratory data. So first you must take the complete history. History will be about the dehydration due to the tablet diseases, due to the other reasons. Number two, the dental infection which causes the inflammation out there. So two things are very, very important. Number first, dental disease and dehydration. Dehydration is also important. Number third is trauma, so the mucosa of the oral cavity of the pharynx, because all these paraffinous spaces are around oral cavity and the pharynx. So this tear in the trauma makes the gateway for the pathogens to enter into the paraffinous spaces or other spaces. So three things in the history, very, very important. Number first, dehydration. Number two, trauma. And third is the dental disease. So you have to go for the physical examination, then the imaging and the laboratory data will be there. Now this is the CT scan. You will see the CT scan where graph is there. Or you see this is the abscess. Now abscess just around this paraffinous space where you have the abscess. Now around the abscess you have the white shadow. Now white shadow of the fibrous tissue, this is abscess, because abscess have the much amount of the water, so their shadow somewhat hypodense. In the CT scan you will find three shadows: hyperdense, hypodense, and acidense. Now this is the shadow of the bone, and shadow of the bone is always the hyperdense because of the maximum amount of the calcium. This is the vertebrae, and now this is the abscess, and this is the paraffinal space. Around it you have the white shadow which is update of the fibrous tissue. This is the acidense shadow which is that of the like brain. So this is the paraffinal space. So imaging study is very, very important to see the where the abscess is there. Now second, you see this one is the retropharyngeal space just behind the vertebrae. Previous CT scan where the abscess was just over there. Now here you will see this is the vertebra, just in front of vertebra you have the prevertebral fascia, and this is the pharynx, just posterior to the pharynx you have the buccopharyngeal fascia. Now constrictor muscles, there is the superior constrictor, middle constrictor, and inferior constrictor muscle. On the anterior side you have the pharyngeal basal fascia, on its posterior side you have the buccopharyngeal fascia. So between the buccopharyngeal fascia and prevertebral fascia there is the retropharyngeal space. So retropharyngeal space is the space between the prevertebral fascia and the buccopharyngeal fascia, which covers the pharyngeal muscles, where you have the abscess formation. This is again the isotense area which shows the retropharyngeal abscess. Now you see again this is the retropharyngeal abscess between the prevertebral fascia and the buccopharyngeal. This is your lateral side. Now this is the paraffinal space where you have the abscess formation is there. So again this is the vertebrae, the paraffinal space like on the lateral side of the vertebrae, and the retropharyngeal space on the interior side of the vertex. This is very easy to differentiate whether it is the retropyrene epsilon or whether it is the paraffinogen spill. Now, if you see that whenever there is abscess formation is there, you have to drain it, or you have to put certain antibiotics. We will discuss it when we come over the treatment. Now again, you will see this is the X-ray of the cervical region. You see this one as the first cervical vertebrae, second vertebrae, third, fourth, fifth, and like this. So these are the cervical vertebrae. In front of it, you have the abscess. This is the retropharyngeal abscess formation. Here you have the pharyngeal muscles. So this is the retropharyngeal abscess. Normally, what happens if you see the radiograph, the diameter of in front of the cervical vertebrae should not be on the one third of the length of the cervical vertebrae. But here you see the length of cervical vertebrae and then the length of the abscess formation. It is just equal to the vertebrae or just behind it. So this is the diameter is greater than depth of the corresponding. Normally this diameter should have been below the half of that cervical vertebrae, but here the diameter beyond that. So it shows there is an abscess in front of the cervical vertebrae. So this is the retropharyngeal abscess on the the X-ray of the cervical vertebrae. Now this is the whenever there's neck abscess, then how will be the presentation of the patient, then how you manage it. Now whenever there's neck abscess, reason of the neck abscess, I have told you, either there's a dehydration when patient is debilitated, patient very weak, patient does not have the oral intake. So in this way, there's a dehydration. Now in this dehydration, anaerobic bacteria become pathogen, aerobic bacteria become pathogen, then they enter into the various paraffinogen species. Number two, when there's injury to the mucosa of the pharynx or the oropharynx, when there's a tear in the mucosa, that also has the pathway for the bacteria to the paraffinogen space or the other species. Third one, when there is the immunocompromised patient or when patient has the antibiotic cover. So when there's a neck abscess, sometimes you have the airway compromise. So you have to secure them. Now the airway compromise will be there when there is submandibular abscess that pushes the tongue backward. So it will compromise the airway. Whenever they compromise the airway, you have to go for the surgical incision and drainage or the tracheostomy. You have to secure the airway at any cost, otherwise you will lose the patient. So whenever there is neck abscess, when it presses the airway, suppose submandibular abscess, it pushes the tongue forward or the pharynx, causes the airway obstruction. When there is paraffinogen space, it causes the edema of the larynx, airway obstruction. Retropharyngeal abscess, again it causes the laryngeal edema, again there is airway obstruction. So you have to secure the airway. Either you go for the surgical incision and drainage to drain the abscess from the space, either you will go for the tracheostomy to secure the airway. If the in the neck abscess, the stable airway is there, patient does not have the compromised airway, then you should go for the imaging. That imaging is either ill-defined or multilocated, or you will go for the well-defined eye. Now, when you will go for the imaging to show the abscess, then you will go for the surgical incision drainage. Then sometimes you go through the blind pathway, or sometimes you go for the ultrasound guided drainage, which is very, very beneficial. Ultrasound guided drainage. Sometimes paraffinogen space is very, very difficult to localize it. Then you can use the US the ultrasound which guide you for the drainage. Okay. Now you see this is the paratonsil abscess. You see this is the tonsil region, and there is the. It is also known as the Quincy peritonsillar abscess or Quincy peritonsillar abscess, and abscess between the tonsillar capsule and the superior constrictor muscle. The abscess between the tonsillar capsule and the superior constrictor muscle that pushes the tonsil forward. And another name of that one is the Quincy peritonsillar abscess or Quincy. Now you can aspirate it, but in the aspiration, whole abscess is very difficult to drain. Then you have to go for the incision and drainage. Now, incision and drainage after peritonsil abscess occurrence is very, very easy. You make two lines. One line is over the base of the uvula, horizontal line, which runs over the lecture. Now the you have to make one line that horizontal to the base of the uvula, and another line which is the vertical line over the anterior transverse pillar. A line from the anterior transverse pillar and one line over the base of the uvula. So when these two lines cross, then you have to give the incision over there and drain all whole of the pus, whatever that may be. So after drainage of the quincy or peritonsil abscess, after 6 months you will go for the tonsillectomy. You have to remove the tonsil because it is a diseased one. Whenever there is the diseased tonsil, because Crypts has the microabscess, you have to remove the tonsil. It is absolute indication once you have the quincy or peritonsil abscess, you have to remove the tonsil, but after 6 months. If you go for the one go, when there is abscess, you will go for the surgery that is known as the heart tonsillectomy. But the disadvantage of that one, that patient may bleed because of the acute inflammation, or sometimes you have the microabscess which travels from the tonsil area to the various parts of the body like the brain, kidney, heart and joints, and causes the multiple problems, arthritis, then the nephritis. So you should avoid the tonsillectomy during the abscess. So first you have to drain it, wait for 6 months, then you have to remove the tonsil, that is known as the cold tonsillectomy. During abscess you can do it, but that is not a heart tonsillectomy. I have said multiple complications because of the abscess. And so this is the all our... Now aspiration, and the aspiration depends upon the site, then the no clear differentiation between cellulitis and abscess. In aspiration it is difficult. Then by aspiration again is the for the diagnostic confirmation. You take the certain material from that area and send for the histopathology and for the culture and sense to see the what type of the pathogen is there. Now sometimes premature incision in area of cellulitis make it worse in this situation by breaking down the natural defense barrier, thus hastening the spread of it. Now natural defenses means this is the bacteria which causes the abscess. Around them there is the reactive fibrosis. Now this reactive fibrosis does not allow the bacteria to spread beyond that one. In previous picture, if you go for that one, you see in yes, you see now this is the abscess, and this white is the fibrous tissues. These are the this is reactive fibrosis. Reactive fibrosis means condensation of the fibrosis or fibrous tissues or connective tissues around the abscess. The condensation of the fibrous tissues around the abscess, this is known as reactive fibrosis, which does not allow the bacteria to travel beyond this limit. So it controls the abscess, it controls the bacteria to travel from here. Now if we go the for incision drainage when it is premature, abscess has been not formed, it is still the cellulitis, if you break this barrier, means you are causing the bacteria to go towards the neighboring structures. Again, it will cause the cellulitis, and sometime through the blood vessels travel towards the far-flung area like the kidneys. So when there are cellulitis, you should avoid the incision and drainage, only go for the aspiration, because incision drainage will break down this barrier. But when there is abscess formation, it is fully flectuated, then you should go for the surgical manual or incision drainage. Here there are chances of minimal for the spread. So this is the why we are avoiding the premature incision, because your natural defense means reactive fibrosis will break down if you go for the incision, that one. Reactive fibrosis is very, very essential to control the spread of the disease. Now this is the peritonsil abscess. It is inflammatory reaction of the tissues between the capsule of the palate tensile and the pharyngeal muscle. The pharyngeal muscle is usually the superior tonsillar muscle. So this is the peritonsillar abscess or the Quincy is there one. Now this is the, again, this one. This is the pus formation. Now here you see there the fully pus formation is, if it would have been a cellulitis, the shadow would have been somewhat white, not that of the black one. So differences between the cellulitis and the abscess, that one in CT scan you will find if the shadow is somewhat black one, but in cellulitis shadow will be of the light in color because of soft tissue. Now around this abscess there the reactive fibrosis. This reactive fibrosis shows the natural barrier over the abscess does not allow the spread of that one. So this is very, very important phenomena where the nature has given the defense mechanism to the abscess or the cellulitis. Now this is the submandibular space, very, very important space. Now you see this is the tongue. Now over the tongue you have the mucous membrane. Now this space is the between the mucous membrane of the tongue and the cervical fascia, which runs from the hyoid bone up to the submental region, up to you have this mandible over the chin of the mandible. So submandibular space, a space between the mucous membrane of the oral cavity or base of tongue up to the deep cervical fascia, which runs from the hyoid bone up to the chin of the mandible. So this is the your submandibular space divided into the two. One is the sublingual and one is the submaxillary space. Sublingual space and submaxillary by the mylohyoid line, where you have attachment of mylohyoid muscle. So mylohyoid muscle, which is attached over the mylohyoid line of the on the inner side of mandible, which divide these two spaces, sublingual space and submaxillary space, and both are known as the submandibular space, and between two you have the mylohyoid line or mylohyoid muscles there. Now this space, usually the inflammation is from the teeth, because the your molar teeth, these are the just below this mylohyoid line, and these are into the submandibular space. So inflammation of these dental inflammation of the molar teeth causes the inflammation of the submaxillary space, and when the there's inflammation of premolar, they causes the inflammation of the sublingual space. So here the 80% of the reason behind this submandibular inflammation is that of the dental in origin. Now this is the, you see the presentation of the submandibular space. This is the, so you have to look first the primary source, which is the dental in origin. You see this one. This is the mandible, and just on the left side you have the abscess. And this is also known as Ludwig angina. Ludwig angina is also submandibular abscess, or Ludwig angina is same thing. So initially there is the cellulitis, there is no need of the insulin drainage. You should go for the broad spectrum antibiotics to control the inflammation and the inflammation subside. But inflammation does not subside, then you have to give the incision, which runs from the one angle of mandible or the another angle of mandible to drain the abscess. But you should avoid incision drainage, because usually this is the inflammation. It is only the inflammation, you have to control it with the broad spectrum antibiotics. And last resource will be the incision drainage. The incision runs from the one angle of mandible or the another angle of mandible, and then you have to train it. But you must look into the dental status of the patient, because the primary reason in case of submandibular abscess is of the dental origin. Now you see this. This is a very, very, now sometimes what happens when there is submandibular abscess, which pushes the tongue, causes the tongue to push upward, and then there is the airway compromise. So this is, you see, bilateral infection of sublingual submucous space. There's first brani edema, elevated tongue will be there, airway obstruction will be there, and passy upper. You see, because of the cellulitis of base of tongue, it pushes upward, and then it causes the compromise of airway, and then you will need the tracheostomy. Tracheostomy is the emergency procedure where you have to save the life of patient. Otherwise, if their tongue is pushed toward the oropharynx, then there's complete plug down of the airway, either from the nose, either from the oral cavity. There will be no air intake. In this way, you have to do the emergency tracheostomy to make the alternate way, pathway for the air passage to the lungs to save the life of the patient. So in case of late one, when tongue is pulled upward, you have to do the tracheostomy to maintain the airway. Now same thing, this is a Ludwig angina or the submandibular space infection where tracheostomy was done. Now again, this is the importance of the penetrating the myelohead muscle for complete drainage abscess, because the myelohead muscle, above the myelohead muscle, you have the sublingual space. You see, this is the parapharyngeal space. Now the parapharyngeal space is very, very important space that is between the mandible and the pterygoid muscles, and this space is potentially theoretic. And this is the where the, you have the important structures like the 9th cranial nerve, 10th cranial nerve, and the 11th cranial nerve. These are very, very important nerves which lies into the parapharyngeal space. Very, very important space between the mandible and the pterygoid muscle. And usually the infection comes from the peritonsil abscess or peritonsillitis, and which is very important because you have the 9th, 10th, 11th cranial nerves are there, you have to save them. Once there is a parapharyngeal space, you have to put the patient on the antibiotics, then you have to drain it. Very, very important structures, 9, 10. And sometimes you have the bursting of the carotid artery, because here you have the carotid arteries there, external carotid arteries there, so you have to save that one. Otherwise, there will be bursting of the carotid artery and you will lose the patient. Again, this is where the parapharyngeal space, this is, you see, this is the mandible is there, on the medial side of mandible you have the parapharyngeal space where you have the abscess there. You have to drain it, otherwise you have the 9th, 10th, 11th cranial nerves that will damage and causes the multiple problems over the patient. And so you have the external carotid arteries there, sometimes they are bursting of the external carotid artery and which causes the sudden death of the patient. You see, this is the cellulitis, complications of that one, and the cellulitis also involves the internal jugular vein sometimes, which causes the thrombophlebitis. Now, Lemierre syndrome means when there the microvilli runs towards the brain, the kidneys, and sometimes goes to the lungs and causes the microabscesses into the both lungs, and this is very, very hazard for the patient, and patient has the respiratory distress. So, Lemierre syndrome means then there's the internal jugular vein thrombosis along with the microemboli in the lung region. Now this is the retropharyngeal space. You see, this is between the buccopharyngeal fascia and the retropharyngeal fascia. This is the retropharyngeal abscess which runs up to the bifurcation of the trachea. You see, this is the retropharyngeal abscess. This one, this is again a very, very dangerous one. If you keep on it, then it causes the damage to the larynx and causes the edema of the larynx, and there's the involvement of the larynx, and then you will see there is a compromise of air. You have to drain it. And drainage is through the, you have the sternocleidomastoid muscle. You must go through the anterior side of the anterior part of sternocleidomastoid muscle, and then you will drain the parapharyngeal space, because this is near the sternocleidomastoid muscle on its anterior side. This is the retropharyngeal abscess. This is the vertebrae. In front of vertebrae, you have the retropharyngeal abscess. This one, and you have to drain. Here you have the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Just on the anterior part of sternocleidomastoid muscle, you have to give the incision on that side. And you will drain very, very easily, very, very easily to drain on the anterior part of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Now, sometimes we have used the antibiotics, the combination of the amoxicillin and clavulanate. This is a very good combination. And you have tried the metronidazole for the anaerobics and the clindamycin. So, metronidazole and this penicillin group of type antibiotics, these are very, very, very important tool to use the when inflammation of the periphery spaces. Now this is the autogenic where you can use the Ceftra as an antibiotic, Betamethasone, which is a very good combination. Or you can use the ciprofloxacin and the clindamycin, and with our experience shows the Ceftriaxone and Metronidazole, these are very, very important tool to use when the inflammation come from the ear or inflammation come from the nose region. When the patient is very immunocompromised, then you have to change the, you can go for the spine, Metronidazole or Amifin, because you have to give the broad spectrum antibiotics to kill the bacteria in case of the immunocompromised patients. The objective of treatment is the, you can go for the aspiration or incision. Aspiration again for diagnostic purpose, where you have to send the pus for the culture and sensitivity. Then you have to go for the antimicrobial therapy and supportive coverage. Then you have to rehydrate the patient, because dehydration is one of the reason behind the inflammation. So you have to rehydrate the patient. Then to go for the in the tear and the mucosa, you have to correct one. Then you see the delta region, you have to correct that one. So you have to put the patient on the multiple therapies to support it. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Any question? Any question, please?
Sir?
Yes?
सर वो जो आपने हाइपरडेंस हाइपोडेंस और आइसोडेंस समझाया था वो थोड़ा रिपीट करेंगे
अच्छा आई विल रिपीट इट डोंट वरी आई विल रिपीट इट ऑन द सीटी स्कैन देयर आर थ्री थिंग्स व्हिच शुड बी नोटेड वन इज द हाइपरडेंस आइसोडेंस एंड द हाइपोडेंस हाइपरडेंस वेयर यू हैव द बोन्स आर हाइपरडेंस बिकॉज़ दे पजेस द कैल्शियम वेयर एवर कैल्शियम इज देयर the shadow will be white in color. White in color is the hyperdense. Hyperdense means white in color. So this is the bones, this is the mandible and this vertebrae. Their color is white, that is the hyperdense shadow. Now the color of the ear, there is a black shadow, this is the color of the ear. Black shadow means it is a hypodense shadow. Hypodense shadow of the, like air, like the lungs, like the larynx, like the pharynx, their shadow will be black in color because they have the air. So their shadow is black, that is the hypodense. Isodense means gray in color, like the, your brain and soft tissues. This is the very soft tissues of tongue, soft tissues of neck region, these are gray in color. So their gray in color means it is isodense shadow. So this is isodense shadow means soft tissue shadow. As if this is an initially stage where you have the cellulitis, their shadow will be isodense shadow, and when the abscess formation is there, their shadow will be somewhat black in color. Any question, please?
Sir, why we do chest CT scanning in the Ludwig's angina?
Yes.
Why we do chest CT scanning in Ludwig's angina?
Ludwig's angina? What we?
Sir, why we do chest CT scanning in Ludwig's angina?
No, we always go for CT scan in Ludwig's angina because we have to see the, any compromise of the airway. Because the 80% of cases you have to tend, we always go for the CT scan in case of Ludwig's angina. But we avoid the incisional drainage because initially only there is a frank secretions, only there is cellulitis. So you have to control it with the drugs like the flagyl and broad spectrum antibiotics. So you have to control it because initially it is only a cellulitis. You have to control it with the antibiotic. If not, then you go for the incision and drainage. CT scan is a tool where you will go for the extent of the disease, extent of the abscess. Yes? Any question, please?
Sir?
Yes?
आपने पेरी टॉन्सिलाइटिस में कहा था कि पहले हम उसको ट्रीट करेंगे फिर 6 मंथ के बाद हम टॉन्सिलेक्टोमी करेंगे लेकिन बुक में लिखा हुआ है 4 टू 6 वीक के बाद कर सकते हैं
यस
नाउ सी आपने मंथ कहा था
यस सी दे नाउ दिस इज द I will show the picture of the peritonsil abscess, and you see this is the peritonsil abscess. You see this one. Now peritonsil abscess means abscess between the superior constrictor muscle and the capsule of tonsil. And tensor capsule of tonsil is not a fully capsule, it is a false capsule, or you can say the half capsule, because it is the condensation of the pharyngeal basilar fascia. So it has the capsule on its lateral side, does not have capsule on the medial side. Now when there is abscess formation, it pushes the tonsil laterally. Now you have to first drain the abscess, whatever it is, and does not we go for the translectomy. Reason is that when if you go for translectomy when abscess there, there are chances that certain maggots throw the blood toward the various organs like the kidneys, like the lungs, like the brain, and form their microabscess and inflammation. Number two, in case of the abscess, you have the more chances of bleeding. So there are much more ability to avoid the bleeding and traveling of these microabscess. We go for the translectomy after 6 months to control the inflammation and infection. First, you have to control the inflammation and infection, then you go for the translectomy. If you go for the translectomy during the abscess, it is also known as the heart translectomy, but it has certain hazard which I have told you. Yes? Any question, please? Okay.
Okay, sir.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much.